Mrparka here to review three from Warlock. I've been sitting on these forever. I picked another one up at Wasteland, so I decided to have a marathon yesterday. I watched two of them, one today. And the first one I'll be talking, if you guys understand what Warlock is essentially kind of like a shout out to Shot on Video and Wizard and things like that back in the day. And they're supposed to be taking place in the 80s. It's supposed to just be really bad Shot on Video movies that were made for the video market. And they're modern and they're supposed to be old. So there we go, we'll hop into it. The first one is DieBQue. Actually, the really cool thing is the cover art on these. This one, I love this cover art. They were released on VHSs too. I probably showed them in videos. I have this one and another one on VHS. Never mind the loud plane. I'm not going to let it distract us, even though it just did. But anyways, what we have here is a story that follows a bunch of ridiculously stupid 80s stereotype people having a barbecue, out to drink, and do a bunch of stupid things. About 40 minutes of the movie is really just the characters doing ridiculous things and doing dumb lines and overacting and nonsense like that until they eat some bad meat that a rodent peed on and turn into, like, zombies, essentially. There's a scene in this movie during the shower scene where one of the main guys, he has a mustache, and he's talking to the character, and their dialogue essentially really is... like, I've seen dialogue that bad in actual film from that time period, so I got a kick out of that. It's like, get out of here, man!
Jesus Christ, man! Scared the shit out of me!
I got you pretty good that time, didn't I?
Yeah, I'll give it to you. That was a pretty good scare. You wanna come in and wash my back?
Gross, dude!
Alright, seriously, man, no. Get out of here. I gotta finish up getting showered. I'll be thinking of your mom the whole time.
Well, tell her I said hi while she's in there with you.
Alright, so seriously, man, get out of here. Go set up the party. They're gonna be here in like a couple hours. Oh, hey, while you're at it, give me another beer.
And it's just intentionally bad. Like, a character has a wig, and his wig disappears and reappears throughout time. And a guy's supposed to be drinking beer. He's drinking a Canadian dry pop. It also has music that you actually know, because for some reason Chris Seaver doesn't seem to give a crap about rights on that kind of stuff, due to him probably not being broadly distributed by, like, a major company. He can get away with that kind of thing. Kind of like the Gutterballs bootleg edition, which had a bunch of 80s music in this. This one does as well. There's really no gore in it, per se, but there is blood. And it is kind of funny, and there is kind of a semi-graphic sex scene. Not really super graphic, but a sex scene in here that seems almost out of place. And I said, it's not like an amazing movie, but it is worth getting a couple kicks out of. And they do the making of behind the scenes where all the characters play actors. So they basically are either tooting their own horns or talking about how this is going to be the next big thing. And obviously it just kind of plays into how embarrassed some of these actors probably would be to actually be in a movie like this. They are hosted by a warlock who basically has all these cheesy one-liners that are absolutely horrible. And of course you can come up with a million with a title like DieBQue. But it's kind of funny, and I really think that some people will get a kick out of DieBQue.
Oh God! Oh.
What the fuck did you do to us? I feel like I'm dying.
Yeah, man! I feel like shit! What? What? Oh. I don't understand what happened. I made it just like Grandma used to, and Grandma's never killed anybody!
It's not my favorite. It's not an amazing piece of cinema, but it's not supposed to be. So, it's short, and it's ridiculously retarded, and there's a couple funny moments in it. Then we have Death-O-Lantern, which I actually like this cover more so. It takes place during Halloween, which automatically makes me a sucker for it. And the thing about Death-O-Lantern is, as cheesy and as bad as it is, the actual story of the pumpkin killer, Stingy Jack, is actually really cool. He came from the 1800s. You kind of, I think, Ernest Scared Stupid meets It, meets a bad Shot on Video slasher movie.
Well, the town legend is cool and all, Phoebes. Do you really think that a pumpkin-headed demon from the 1800s is doing all this nasty stuff?
I don't know what to think, but there's some serious connections between now and then. Listen to this. According to town records, the child murders of Sleepy Hollow Heights began in 1820. Stingy Jack, the town drunk, was known for his hatred of children and for playing horrible tricks on kids during the yearly Halloween festivities. On Halloween night that year, Jack's pranks went too far, and he actually killed a child. The town of Sleepy Hollow Heights persecuted him and sentenced Jack to death. While waiting to be executed, Jack struck a deal with the devil that would make his death only temporary. According to the legend, the deal was that Jack's ghost would be freed to haunt the town of Sleepy Hollow Heights for the next 3 days of every year, October 29th, 30th, and 31st. If he managed to kill 6 children over these 3 days in any single year, he would be returned to his human form and be free to walk the land of the living once again. Hold on, because there's more. In 1821, the year after Jack's death, 3 child murders occurred between October 29th and October 31st. In 1822, 2 children were killed right before Halloween. This pattern continued throughout the years, and many think the ghost of Stingy Jack was responsible, and he was trying to fulfill his pact with the devil by taking vengeance out on the town's children. Yet, there were never more than 5 child deaths recorded around Halloween in any year following, meaning Jack's plans to reach a total of 6 were always thwarted. The child deaths continued intermittently around Halloween for years, but seemed to die out in the mid-1950s. Get this, you guys. According to the legend, when Jack returned every fall to kill, he would appear in the form of a pumpkin-headed creature of the night. And at the site of each child murder, a single lit pumpkin was always left behind, as a message to the townspeople that it was really him.
This has chilled me to the bone, you guys. I didn't know the whole story.
I can't believe it, guys. This is almost too ridiculous to believe. But there were jack-o'-lanterns at every single one of the crime scenes, so maybe Stingy Jack has returned.
Well, there are kids being killed this Halloween, and whoever or whatever is doing it must know the Stingy Jack legend. So, what's the plan, fearless leader?
I was thinking we go out tonight and investigate. Do a little stakeout action. Maybe we can catch whoever or whatever is killing kids in the act.
It's fun in the fact that he actually leaves a pumpkin in every death scene, and I love pumpkins in movies. The death scenes, again, nothing amazing, just more so blood, cheesy one-liners, people overacting, giving high fives and whatnot, and people might recognize Clint Kelly in this one as a Dutch Hogan. He used to do YouTube videos, he's a really cool guy. And him and his buddy, they're in a horror club, and there's obvious shouts to tons of 80s stuff, Fred Decker movies, Night of the Creeps is playing on the screen. They talk about Shadowbrook Road, which would be for Monster Squad. So if you kind of like shot on video, I mean, like I said, sometimes these are so bad they're not watchable, which is actually kind of funny. There's so much noise, it's ridiculous, sorry guys. But this plane's just circling around advertising some crap fest. There it is. Go somewhere else, we don't care. No one in this neighborhood has money.
No one can even read that sign.
It's backwards.
It's not 1920. Go on.
Regardless. anyways, I actually enjoyed this one. I found a lot of humor in it, and the bowling scene and taking place in a theater. It just was fun. The killer's one-liners are really entertaining and whatnot. And I love pumpkins. That's all I gotta get to. Both are horrible. Both take place supposedly in 1986. Both are entertaining, though. And
come to me. My giant. Jack be nimble. Jack be quick. Jack kill child with a candlestick.
Ah!
One child soul devoured! Five to go!
The final one is probably the weakest. It's Death of Lantern 2, which is the most recent. This one supposedly takes place in 1986. This one takes place in modern day. They're all shot on video, like I said. But this one, it has the lady from the original running a Halloween house so people can get over the fears of Halloween. Obviously, she has a big one because Stingy Jack killed her friends. Bring back three of the same four actors in the movie, or five actors in the movie, one playing a different character. One comes back even though he's already dead and explains ridiculous points. Clint Kelly, he actually is pretty funny in the point. During serious scenes, they'll automatically cut in and start talking about food when they're about to be killed. And it's just so ridiculous and is also very funny.
So as I was saying, I think brie is really one of the best type of cheeses. You can slice it up with a little tomato. You can even put it in a pork pie sandwich and eat it all together. It's quite a delectable snack.
I could get down with that.
You can put a little betwixt your teeth, too, and just munch it between your gums like you're eating chewing tobacco. It's actually quite good, and what I like to do is put it in between my toes, just like the French used to do. Then I take it betwixt my toes, put it into my buttocks, and then I like to eat it sideways with a piece of banana. They betrayed me! The neuromancers, they replaced my heart with an apple! Phoebe!
You've been apple jacked!
Liz!
Pickled cabbage on French bread, Phoebe. It's delicious.
An apple a day didn't keep Jack away!
I don't believe this.
Ongoing joke about her keeping her pubic region trim. Very lowbrow, stupid, generic humor that anyone who ever used to pick up a camera and have fun with their friends would definitely get a kick out of and have fond memories of. The movie ends in a music video for no reason, like a music video montage, which a lot of 80s movies would do that kind of crap for just the hell of doing it. And that part's actually really funny. Some points seem embarrassingly bad, but these people show absolutely no shame in what they're doing, and you can tell they're having a good time while doing it, so it adds a certain charm to it. I don't understand how to explain it, but watching it, I understood that this was an atrocity, but I yet was entertained throughout the entire thing. All three of these, I think, if people want to check them out, if it sounds like it's up your alley, definitely check out the first Death of Lantern, if I don't drop it. But I think Death of Lantern is the best of the bunch, and I do think there's a couple scenes. I'll show a couple scenes here and there, and you guys will get the gist of it. It's Warlock videos. They did Dingleberries, which I did not like, and among tons of other ones as well. But if this sounds like it's up your alley, then check it out. I mean, it's kind of cool that they're doing bring back of shot on video movies. So, bye.
Oh no, is Jack coming back?
More cars.